NBA series between the Celtics and the Hawks is the theme of our show, On the Way It Was. Kurt Gowdy, your host, and welcome to our series of American Sports Classics. This week, basketball, and two unforgettable series in NBA history. The 57 and 58 championships between the Boston Celtics and the St. Louis Hawks. And to help us relive that memorable series, let's meet the 50th Division champion, the Boston Celtics. An All-American from Holy Cross, number 15, Tommy Heinsohn. Voted an all-time NBA great from the University of Southern California, he played in the backcourt, number 21, Bill Sharman. Hall of Fame coach Arnold Red Auerbach. Those are the Eastern Division champion Boston Celtics. Now let's meet the Western Division challengers, the St. Louis Hawks. Also voted to the all-time NBA team, another Hall of Famer, forward number 9, Bob Pettit. The ex-Celtic Hall of Famer, he was at forward, number 20, Easy Ed McCauley. And another great All-American from the University of Kentucky, number 6, Cliff Hagan. Those are the Western Division champs, the St. Louis Hawks. The man who called the play-by-play, the voice of the Boston Celtics, who I think is one of the greatest basketball broadcasters of all time, Johnny Most. Game two, remember, this is the series of 1958. The defending champs, the Celtics, have been upset in the opening game of the series. We're now in the Boston Garden, the play-by-play voice of Johnny Most.
It's game number two of the 1958 World Championship Series between the Hawks and the Celtics. And Sharman gives the ball back over to Cousy. Cousy bringing that ball up to the left. Now he comes cross court on the right. Now to Sharman off the pick. Back out it goes to Cousy. Cousy off the pick, swings to the right, throws one up. Whoosh. Once again now Ramsey quickly over to Russell. Sharman behind the pick. Sharman goes left, comes back to the right, goes baseline, fakes, has the ball knocked loose, picks it up and hits. All right, on the left side, Cousy trying to start the break. Comes off the screen. On the right, it goes to Ramsey for a runner. It's up and in. Boston is pouring it on, trying to get back in the series. They trail one game to none. They're out in front by 14. Carr quickly in the pivot. It goes to Hagan. Hagan takes it up to the top of the key for a hook shot. That's good. On the right side, once again, the Hawks bring it down baseline. Hagan, a jumper. It's good. All right, we're in the fourth quarter. The Celts have a big lead. Now they work the ball around on the right side. The Hawks do it. Goes quickly over to Hagan, driving right baseline. The hook is good. Hagan has 30 points as the Hawks try to rally. Now a drive is blocked. The ball knocked around. Cousy picks it up, comes to the right. He fakes behind the back to Sharman. Daylight, the jumper. Bang! The Celts are in a commanding position with time running out. The weave. The shot is blocked by Russell. The ball picked up by the Celtics. A fast break to Sharman. He lays it up and in. And the Celtics win the second game, 136-112, and tie up the series at one game apiece. The team split games 3 and 4, but Russell got hurt in the third game, did not play in games 4 and 5. The fifth game was won by the Hawks. They go up 3-2 in the series. At the start of the fourth quarter, the Hawks are up by 1. McMahon up top, goes to Martin. Martin holding the ball on the left, brings it out to the middle of Hagan. Hagan weaves to the left, gives to Scheer for a right-hand hook. It's good! Late in the ball game, the Hawks are now behind. Pettit hits a baseline jumper. Pettit comes right back and hits a jumper from the right side. Pettit comes right back, drives baseline, and lays one up and in. Now, on the left, Pettit feeds off to Hagan. Hagan, a hook shot. It's up and good. With only seconds remaining, the Celtics are trailing by 3 points. Sharman drives, lays it up and in. They're down 110-109. They're fighting to get the ball back. The Hawks are protecting the ball. Martin moving it around, trying to keep out of trouble. is in trouble. Gets the ball over to McCauley, and McCauley stumbles and runs out the clock. The Hawks win the 1958 World Championship, the final score of the sixth game, 110-109.
So that's one of your most memorable games, wasn't it, Bob?
By far and away, Kurt. It's the greatest thrill I've not had in basketball.
Yeah. That's the best game you ever played, do you think?
Well, I think because it meant so much, I'd have to say it was. I don't think there's, you know, there are not many situations that you come down to the final game of a series. And, of course, it was the sixth game, and we knew that we had to win it that night. We'd already beaten Boston twice in Boston in that series, and it was very doubtful if we went back to the seventh game that we would be able to beat them. There was that possibility. So we felt that our real chance was to win it that night in St. Louis.
And in this particular ball game, everybody was trying to take a shot at defending Pettitte. And Lou Chiaropoulos, at this point, was assigned the task of doing a tune on Bob Pettitte. And Johnny Most, who's been my good friend for many years, almost 20 years now, is broadcasting the game, and he says, "And Pettitte and Chiaropoulos is doing a fantastic defensive job on Pettitte. Here we are in the third quarter. What a fantastic job Chiaropoulos is doing on Pettitte. Pettitte's only got 34 points."
No Victory cigar that day, huh, Red?
Well, you got to give a blind hog an acorn every once in a while.
Who said he was a sweet old man? Wow. How many years ago was that? 800 years ago, he's still complaining. Yeah. He won how many titles, John?
11.
11 out of 12 years. He wants
11
the 12th
and 13.
One. You talk about a competitor, he wants the 12th one back.
They played great, and, you know, Russell was hurt, but we never talked about that very much because he did play in the game that we lost. So we've got to give St. Louis credit for it. They were a great competitive team, and we knew we were always in for a fight right down the wire with them. And that was a great championship they won that year.
Kurt, may I say a little bit, just a second, about the Celtics? You know, I really feel that, as far as I'm concerned, it was the greatest team ever put together in sports. I don't care how far back you go.
Yeah, I agree.
I've heard of a lot of them. But I think the thing that people don't really realize, it was a great collection of athletes and coached by the greatest coach, I think, that's ever been. The thing that Red did so well was he kept them playing together as a team and kept them motivated.
Now,
can you imagine trying to motivate this great collection of players night after night, season after season for 11 or 12 years?
Yankees, Packers, Celtics, Oklahoma, any great organization, it's easy to go soft. Like you said earlier, we win the first one now. But that's the real test. When you can keep winning and keep
Well, another better. Tribute to a good coaching job is your alumni and what they do. And in the case of the Celtics, their alumni have all gone on. Well, many of them have gone on to become great coaches of their own. And I think that some of that has to be a throwback to their training and their background when they were with the Celtics.
Kurt, I think everybody here has coached at one time or other. Even Bob Pettitte coached a game or two in the NBA. And I think we overlooked our coach in St. Louis, who was Alex Hannum at the time, who was
He's
the
a
coach
great one
the year
too.
We won the championship, and he did one whale of a job.
We want to thank the members of the Boston Celtics, the champs of 57, St. Louis Hawks, who won it in 58, and the exciting play-by-play announcing of Johnny Most. This is Kurt Gowdy saying, that's the way it was when the Hawks and Celtics battled in 1958 for the World Professional Basketball Championship.